You're listening to the Future Composer Podcast, a show that empowers composers, musicians, and artists with knowledge. Now, here's your host, John Presley.
Ian and Sofia Hultquist are composers with equally impressive resumes, but together they are a husband and wife duo making waves for their innovative film scores. Ian is originally from Chicago and Sofia hails from Florence, Italy, and they met at Boston's Berklee College of Music where they both studied film scoring. Ian combined his love of electronic and rock music to become a founding member of the band Passion Pit, while Sofia's pursuit of composition led her to a master's degree in music technology at New York University. They have an impressive list of film scores, side projects, commercials, and more, and they're just a few years into their careers as professional composers. Ian and Sofia, welcome to the Future Composer Podcast. It's great to talk with both of you today.
Hello.
So tell me, when you first met, did you ever imagine in a million years you'd actually be working together scoring films?
I don't know.
I may have daydreamed about it, but I didn't know if it was an actual possibility.
Yeah, I feel like neither of us really knew what we wanted to do. And I feel like we graduated in 2008 in such a weird kind of economic climate. You know, like the stock market crashed like 2 months after we got our degrees. And it was one of those things where it was like, I don't think any fantasy that we had of like going to Hollywood and doing all that kind of got put on hold. And Ian just kind of took, you know, the band that he was in. He was like, I think I'm going to give this a shot. And I was like, okay, well, I'll hold down the fort in Boston and I'll just work in music and, you know, we'll just make it work. So it's kind of surreal that it's happened.
So before we get into a little more of your background, your education, I'd like to talk about your most recent project, scoring the first Monday in May, a new doc that offers an intimate look at what really goes into one of the fashion industry's biggest events. I'd love for you to tell me about the film a little bit and kind of what soundscape you created for it and choices you made for the score.
So this was actually my third time working with Andrew Rossi on a film. He directed Ivory Tower, which was my first full-length documentary from a couple years ago. And then he brought me back last year when he was producing Thought Crimes. It was a documentary directed by Aaron Lee Carr. So actually last year at Tribeca, he said, I have something new coming up and it's actually about fashion. So what if you and Sofia scored it together? Start working right away. And from there, I think maybe late spring last year, we kind of started coming up with a few ideas, but we hadn't really seen much footage yet. And we knew the premise of the film, but we didn't really know what the real story was yet.
Yeah, and I don't think they necessarily did either. They started filming really, really early on in the process. And I think that they were figuring out what the, you know, because you can't really know when you do a documentary if there's going to be a breaking point or, you know, if it's even going to happen, because I feel like, you know, or where the drama was going to be. But we eventually got kind of like a rough cut and started working. And I mean, the documentary ultimately is following Andrew Bolton of the Costume Institute at the Met and Anna Wintour, head honcho over at Vogue, and who just had the Costume Institute renamed in her name. And essentially it's just they're different, they're parallel, but very different roads to creating the exhibit and the Met Ball, the Met Gala, and just kind of going back and forth with like, is all fashion art, and also how much commerce needs to go into fashion, and does that take away the artistic side? So I think that's really like the big debate in the documentary.
And then musically, when we first came on, Andrew Rossi was like, oh, maybe just do like some ambient pads and stuff, and that would probably be enough for the film, which I should have known better, because after the other two films I'd done with him, they're usually lots and lots of music. But that's what we started with, and we spent like early summer just playing around with a lot of analog and digital synths and creating like kind of ambient soundscapes and things, almost like stuff you'd hear in the background if you were walking through a museum itself. And then from there, I think once the main story points started coming together in the edit, we branched out quite far and then started writing pieces for a chamber orchestra, and then even branched out further from then again and started writing almost some kind of like electro pop indie band type music.
I mean, it could be categorized into three different things. One being kind of like the Met storyline, one being the Vogue storyline and the other being the exhibit itself as like three characters. So I think the sonic palettes are kind of following these three overarching themes.
So how are you able to divide up responsibilities? Because I know that you are both accomplished and able to create your own scores on your own, work on your own, but as you come together, husband or wife or any composing duo, you know, and not that it's that unusual, but it's obviously a split of responsibilities and who's doing what and who's going to score this and just the general responsibilities for getting the task done. I'm just curious how you divided that up and conquered this.
It took a little bit. I feel like even though we are together all the time and are constantly trying to work with each other, we're still both very set in our ways when it comes to actually writing. So the first month and a half was a lot of like, hey, I'll do this and then you do this and we'll come together and work on after that and see how it goes.
Which we'd done in the past with remixes.
Yeah.
Like, one of our side projects.
We were used to that.
One of us would start it and then we, you know, the session, the like one cue or one track would go from like computer to computer, back and forth. So that's how we started. But
then after those few weeks, we actually hit a point where we were able to kind of be in the same room together and start from scratch. And by the end, it got to the point where we were both sitting at like the master keyboard controller in the studio playing at the same time. And we were comfortable enough to do that with each other.
Wow. That's talented. Let's talk a little bit about the challenges of scoring docs in general. There's so many different types of documentaries, so many different ways that they use music, from a lot of score to no score at all. So for our listeners, what are some general principles you can share about scoring docs? I know you have this relationship with this director and you've got to know him and how he works and what he wants. But just in general, when you sit down to watch a film that's been given to you, you're working on it, what are some of those key guiding principles that you can share with people that you've learned along the way?
I mean, in a way, it kind of goes the same as it can with a narrative film. I mean, I think most important with the documentary is you want to help keep the story moving, but you also really want to stay out of the way. Most people don't necessarily go see a documentary to hear like an amazing score. It's usually just like a plus if you get to hear that as well. For narratives, obviously, you have like a bit more artistic freedom to kind of have the music have a bit more of a spotlight every now and then. But for documentary, most of the time, you really just kind of want to be able to follow along with what's happening on screen. And you also have to be very, like for the ones I've done for Rossi that we've done, they jump around from genre to genre and tone to tone so quickly that you really kind of have to be up on your toes quite a bit.
And you have to be able to be really flexible and really, you know, obviously this is the case for all scoring and working with all directors, but in documentaries, because the story jumps around so much, you just have to have faith that when the director tells you that, like, there's going to be 8 cues in the first 15 minutes of the film, and they're all very different, like, to just believe that he knows what he's doing and just go along and just, you know, buckle up and do it. And as Ian, to kind of reiterate Ian's what he said, it kind of, you have to really decide whether the music is going to be passive or like a little bit more driving. And I think that that's something that with documentaries, because documentaries, there's a lot more, you know, like whether it's showing an exhibit or it's a lot more kind of like long takes, you need to know whether the music needs to like be up front and helping the image or whether you're supposed to be able to zone out and be like, oh, there was music there, but I didn't notice it. So
it's also, it's also really tricky depending on the workflow of the documentarians, but a lot of the time you start working before you have somewhat of a locked cut. And the story can change so drastically from when you first sign on to when it's actually finished. And then it can even change again after that, which I've seen before. So that's another thing to keep in mind is like you really just kind of have to be prepared to think creatively, try to lock in with your director and editors as quickly as you can. It's tough. Documentaries are hard work.
Yeah, and don't be fooled. They'll tell you at the beginning that it's not going to be wall-to-wall music, but like 90% of the time, it's like wall-to-wall music.
Yeah.
Well, it can be a good thing. We like to make music, so.
Yeah.
So let's go back to your education a bit. You've both attended some really prestigious music schools. I know there's so many things you've learned that you couldn't possibly just sum it up for me, but I am curious, what did you learn in school that you're applying right now every single day to scoring, just that key thing that every day you're pulling back to that, what you learned there?
One really big thing, which actually doesn't really have to do with music as much, is just being organized. Because I feel like it was one of those things where, like, I think at Berklee, they wouldn't accept a file or a paper or whatever if it wasn't, like, formatted correctly. And at the time, you kind of, you know, you're like, oh, like, why does that even matter? But now it's like we constantly, luckily, get people being like, wow, you guys are so organized. Thanks for, like, you know, whether it's like a Dropbox file or whether it's a SoundCloud link or, you know, you just getting everything formatted and just making sure that you're organized. Because, like, you'd never know, like, not only are you going to be on revision, like, version 6, but you might be on version 6D for all that you know. And if you don't know where your sessions are, like, that's a big waste of time for you and for the people you're working with. So yeah. I think that...
I mean, that's something that I think we're both constantly working at, is just, like, new ways to stay as organized and clear about what you're working on as possible.
Yeah.
Other things, I think one of the biggest things about, I've met a lot of musicians lately who are coming from the band world that want to get the scoring and kind of like follow a little bit of the same path that I have. The biggest thing that I think it's maybe a bit of a shock at first is that you're not the director of the film. You're the composer, and it's, I mean, obviously you're going to put your voice into it, but it's not necessarily your film. It's the director's film, it's the producer's film, and you are at their mercy, to, more or less. I think that's something that is always good to remind yourself of. That's always helpful. I like the fact, like, I don't have a problem with that. But I know some other people who are very used to kind of having artistic freedom. It's hard when you're kind of met with criticism or notes for the first time and you don't really know what to do with it.
I think that's great, and you're there to serve the director, you're there to provide value to their project, but that goes back to you have the opportunity to make your own music and your own creative statement with your own band, your own side project, your own albums, and so there's a place for that, and I know you've both had those experiences, those bands, those projects. I'm curious how important that is to you, how that plays into what you do now. Obviously, you probably learned to do a lot of what you're doing from even a technical side from doing those bands and being in those projects. I'm curious why that's important to you and how that informs what you do now.
I think the good thing of coming from more of a band or more kind of a free creative space is that you end up creating things that are original and that you have your own sound in. Whereas, you know, people that haven't been able to explore that might kind of, I mean, because there really is something when you come out of any music school that's, you know, as thorough as Berklee or like a USC or like anything like that, you essentially get taught all the rules so that then you in your own time can experiment and know how to break them. And I feel like if you don't have that artistic outlet of whether it's a side project or a band or just writing for yourself, you're always going to get stuck writing the way that they taught you, which is great if you're doing, you know, like a car commercial or like whatever, and it's, you know, you're going to have that really great commercial sound, but I think that we lately have been getting hired because we don't necessarily sound like the formatted, like, package.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that being and doing all these weird side projects, like, has given us a little, our music, a little bit of an edge.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I think for me, the biggest thing that I learned from my years on the road was how to work with people in stressful environments. I honestly think that I don't know if I'd be able to keep up as well as I have so far if I hadn't toughened up my skin a bit on the road, you know, dealing with being on stage with keyboards breaking, stuff happening off stage, constantly traveling and having to keep up. It was like a boot camp kind of to like, granted, and now I'm pretty stationary. I stay in the studio all day, but like my mind has to stay busy and keep track of emails and keep track of all the notes you're getting and all the different projects that are happening. So I think just working with people is such an important thing that not everyone gets a chance to do necessarily if they just jump straight into scoring.
So let's jump to the technical side a little bit. We'll geek out on your workspace, your studio, and tell me everything you want to tell me about your instruments, your hardware, your software, your synths, why you use what you use. Tell me about it.
Oh, man. I think I'm going to start because I have a less impressive space that I work in, even though then the studio is always kind of where the final mixing and any kind of instrument addition happens. But personally, I still love working in Ableton. So I have an Ableton push that I use when I make beats and do sampling. I have a keyboard.
Do you have a native instrument?
Yeah, I have a complete control keyboard. I use the OP1, the Teenage Engineering mini synth a lot. I'm really looking forward to getting this Kickstarter synth actually called the Parva by a company called Future Sonus, which should hopefully arrive soon.
Yeah.
And then honestly, all I have is just like a Neve preamp. I'm still working on an old Apogee for my interface, really old. And I mean, I feel like that's kind of what I have because I work in what is essentially where people who come visit stay. So it has to be, it can't be like much of a, I guess, a lady cave, just because it has to like look
lady cave. Wow.
Because that's the look. Yeah, it just feels weird to call it a man cave. And but then, I mean, if I ever need a synth and like, you know, I'll let Ian take it away from here.
Yeah. Well, so when we were living in New York up until 2 years ago, my studio was the right corner of the living room and Sophia's was the left corner of the living room. So there wasn't a lot of room to have anything in there because, you know, it was also a living room. So when we moved out to Los Angeles, I built, the garage was already kind of walled in and I kind of took it over and turned it into my studio. And it's constantly growing. There's a lot of synths. There's a Dave Smith, Moog, Roland, a Mellotron. There's a lot of guitars that I've collected over the years. And Cubase has kind of become my main DAW lately. I still use Ableton a lot. I still use Pro Tools a lot. Weirdly enough, I'm still running everything off one laptop, which I'm kind of embarrassed to say, but I just haven't gotten around to getting the new Mac Pro trash can yet. There's a little bit of outboard gear. I've got a couple EQs, compressors, API preamps, Chandler preamps, and I'll stop there before I keep going on longer.
Well, I'm looking at my trash can right now. It's really nice. It is worth getting. But, you know, there's no right answer for what works for you. But I'm curious, talking about all these synths, I mean, when you're creating these scores and maybe you're working with something that's more got more synth bass, are you working out of the box, in the box? Are you... I'm curious about that balance between that, especially when you talk about you're having to revise things tell me more about that workflow.
It's a big mix. I have terabytes worth of samples, sample libraries. Sophie and I both use Diva and Zebra by Yuhi a lot, those synthesizers. A lot of the time it depends on what our time is, what our budget is. If we have the opportunity to explore some of the actual hardware synths a bit more, I'm trying to get to the point where like I'm good enough with them that even if I don't only have a couple hours to do something, I can do it quickly and know how to get the right result. But you know, depending on what synth you're using, that's not always the case. So it really comes down to what's going to be easiest. And if you know you have a project that's going to have a ton of revisions, like it really is difficult to have to go back and redo things over and over and over again if it's all live.
So as we start to wrap up, I'd love to know what your plans are for the future, what types of projects you're looking to work on and why.
Well, we're looking forward to working more together because I feel like our styles are and our kind of aesthetics are different. So when we get to work together, we get to kind of bring the best of both worlds together to make something that I feel like we wouldn't have been able to make on our own. But personally, I compose a lot for fashion, whether it's fashion film or soundscapes for presentations for Fashion Week. And I would love to keep doing that. Would love to, you know, kind of see the medium of fashion film and the sound design that comes with it and would not kind of develop into a more full-fledged thing. So personally, I mean, working in film, but also continuing with fashion work, you know, bigger shows. So...
And then I'm halfway through my first TV show ever, which has been quite a learning experience for the past couple of months, but it's been really fun. I'd love to maybe try to do another one once this wraps up. I have at least one film that's going to be coming up in about a month or so that I'm really excited to get working on, but I don't know if I can announce it yet. but there's definitely stuff coming up. I think both of us just want to keep going. You know, like, it's been a really good 2 years since we came out here of just being able to constantly get work happening without too many lulls in between. And I think ideally we'd like to just keep that running.
Maybe with a little more free time, a little less hustle.
A little less
waking up in the middle of the night being like, damn it, did I write back to that email kind of thing.
Less hustle and bigger budgets, and we'll be happy.
That's great. Well, just like a composer I talked to a few weeks ago, he said as soon as you want a new project, just book a vacation, and then immediately you're going to get a huge project, and you have to cancel your vacation. So.
Oh, my God. We tried to go to Tahoe twice this year, like literally like paid for the trip and everything and had to cancel the morning we were supposed to leave. Twice.
We've definitely missed out on a large number of vacations in the past few years
we've been doing this. And some, like, kind of minor family things. I mean, it's just...
Yeah. You gotta...
You do what you gotta do, though.
It's part of the game.
Yeah, it is a game.
Always being available.
Well, it sounds like you all are doing great so far, and it's been awesome to talk today. I appreciate the insight. I know there's a lot of great info in this interview for our listeners, and I'm looking forward to hearing a lot more from both of you as you continue your careers.
Thanks so much.
Thank you so much.
All right, thanks. We'll talk soon.
You've been listening to the Future Composer Podcast. For more podcast episodes and in-depth articles, visit futurecomposer.com. To learn more about our host, visit johnpresleymusic.com.